Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents An Independent Empire, Diplomacy and War in the Making of the United States by Michael S. Kochin and Michael Taylor. Narrated by Walter Dixon. Introduction. An Independent Empire. The rebellious war now levied is become more general and is manifestly carried on for the purpose of establishing an independent empire. King George III's Address to Parliament, October 27, 1775. On a frozen morning in February 1807, in a Colorado wilderness, bound in the adamantine chains of winter, Zebulon Pike was informed of the report of a gun. Pike was 28 years old, a captain in the United States Army, and a man devoted to the arts and science of warfare. The son of a military father, he claimed to have read every book which could be procured in the French and English language on my profession. Pike was also a celebrated pioneer of the new American West, who had led a damned set of rascals to the headwaters of the Mississippi River in 1805. On this cold February morning in 1807, when a gunshot broke the hibernal silence, Pike was the commanding officer of another daring frontier expedition. But Captain Pike was in the wrong place. 8 months previously, he had received his orders from General James Wilkinson, the senior officer of the Army. Pike's destination was the west of Louisiana, the vast continental territory that the United States had just acquired from Napoleonic France. Ostensibly, the purpose of the mission was scientific. "In the course of your tour," wrote Wilkinson, "you are to remark particularly upon the geographical structure, the natural history, and population of the country through which you may pass." The American explorers were instructed to take particular care to collect and preserve specimens of everything curious on the mineral or botanical worlds which can be preserved and are portable. Wilkinson also relayed an order from the highest heights of the federal government. "It is an object of much interest with the executive," he told Pike, "to ascertain the direction, extent, and navigation of the Arkansas and Red Rivers." Having overseen the Louisiana Purchase in 1803, President Thomas Jefferson now wanted to know what he had bought. However, Wilkinson's orders also came with a warning. "The head branches of the Arkansas and Red Rivers," he advised, "were approximate to the settlements of New Mexico, the Spanish colony that stretched from Juarez in the south to present-day Colorado in the north." Pike was cautioned to move with great circumspection, to keep clear of any hunting or reconnoitering parties from that province, and to prevent alarm or offense. The Spanish government in New Mexico was not to be disturbed, for "the affairs of Spain and the United States appear to be on the point of amicable adjustment." Wilkinson emphasized how President Jefferson wished to cultivate the friendship and harmonious intercourse of all the nations of the earth, and particularly our near neighbors, the Spaniards. In other words, Pike was told not to cross the Spanish border, and, if that was impossible, not to get caught. The Pike expedition left Fort Bellefontaine on the south bank of the Missouri River in July 1806. Besides 51 Osage Indians who had recently been ransomed by the United States, Pike took with him 2 lieutenants, 1 surgeon, 1 sergeant, 2 corporals, 16 privates, and 1 interpreter. At first, the expedition enjoyed no little success. Pike's men returned the Osages to their homeland and then forced the Pawnees of southern Nebraska to raise the American flag in place of the Spanish. Yet, by late October, the expedition had split in two. 5 men and 2 Osage scouts followed Lieutenant James Wilkinson, the son of the general, back down the Arkansas River, while 13 enlisted men, the surgeon, and the interpreter plowed on with Pike. From here, wrong turn followed wrong turn. Soon caught between the wilds of winter and the insolence, cupidity, and barbarity of the savages, Pike and his men resolved to build a stockade in a small prairie on the west fork of the Red River. As the palisades rose from the ground, Pike spent his days reading, hunting deer, and refreshing his memory as to the French grammar. Heeding some of his instructions from Wilkinson, Pike also investigated the wild terrain around his base, marveling at the numerous springs which issued from the foot of the hill opposite to our camp, which were so strongly impregnated with mineral qualities as to keep clear of ice. This serene exploration was not to last. In mid-February, during one of his many sorties, Pike and a companion were spied from the summit of a hill by a Spanish dragoon and a civilized Indian. Mindful not to give alarm or offense to America's neighbors, Pike strove to lose the scouts to avoid further exposure. But the Spaniard and the Indian would not be deterred. Giving chase through the ice and snow of the cold western winter, they pursued Pike, at full charge, flourishing their lances. And when at last the four met in a ravine, pleasantries were exchanged only with great precaution. The tension eased. Pike invited the Spaniard and the Indian back to the American stockade, and his unwelcome guests eventually left without incident. But Pike was unnerved. He now feared another attention from the Spaniards or their emissaries. And so, later that month, when his lookout heard gunfire and reported the approach of strangers, Pike was not surprised. The strangers were Frenchmen in the service of the Spanish crown, and they claimed to come with an offer of help. The Utah Indians, they told Pike, were planning to attack the Americans, but the benevolent governor of New Mexico, Joaquin del Real Alencaster, would not stand for such atrocity. 50 dragoons were being sent to the aid of Pike and his men. The promised dragoons arrived almost immediately, and with them, ominously, were 50 mounted militia of the province, armed in the same manner, viz. Lances, escopetas, and pistols. Unable to protest, Pike welcomed the Spanish officers inside, and they breakfasted on some deer, meal, goose, and some biscuit. The Americans hoped that if they parlayed, and if the Spanish simply returned to New Mexico, a diplomatic crisis could be avoided. But this hope proved false. "Sir," the Spanish told Pike, "the governor of New Mexico, being informed you had missed your route, ordered me to offer you, in his name, mules, horses, money, or whatever you may stand in need of, to conduct yourself to the head of the Red River." "What?" interrupted the American. "Is this not the Red River?" "No, sir," came the reply. It was the Rio del Norte. Pike, the great explorer, was mortified. He had confused the rivers and inadvertently erected his palisades on Spanish soil. "I ordered my flag to be taken down and rolled up," he noted, feeling how sensibly I had committed myself in entering their territory. Pike and his men were promptly arrested and marched southward through Santa Fe and Albuquerque, coming at last to Los Cabos in Chihuahua. It was not until July, 5 months after his apprehension, that Pike was returned to the United States, appropriately on the Red River in Louisiana. Pike's abortive foray into the West might be considered a curious place to start any history of the United States. Certainly, the Pike expedition is much less known than the widely lauded Lewis and Clark expedition, and for good reason. Meriwether Lewis and William Clark charted a course from St. Louis to the Pacific Ocean and back again, laying the path for the westward expansion of the United States, and so their names belong to the American pantheon. Zebulon Pike got lost, captured, and humiliated. His reputation for posterity was secured only at the Battle of York, 1813, where he was fatally wounded during the American victory over the British. Yet of these two explorations of the American West, the Pike expedition better reflects the early imperial history of the United States. In trying to conduct official business in alien, unforgiving environments, Pike was undermanned and under-resourced, just as the early federal government struggled to impose order on the enormous American continent. On his travels, Pike was obliged to deal with Native American tribes, both friendly and hostile, just as the federal government was forced to treat and fight with the Iroquois, the Western Confederacy, the Creeks, and the Seminoles to the east of the Mississippi River. Pike also struggled to avoid conflict with a rival empire, just as the United States sought to avoid open war with the British, French, and Spanish. The failure of the Pike expedition remains a salutary reminder of the uncertain prospects of the early republic itself. Indeed, the transformation of 13 British colonies into the United States of America, and then into one of the great powers of the world, is the most remarkable story in modern political history. When the seeds of the American Revolution were first sown in the 1760s, the 13 colonies were but a string of coastal settlements along the eastern seaboard, mere pawns in the imperial games of the old world. That those colonies would even attempt to overthrow the might of the British Empire was, for many observers on both sides of the Atlantic, simply absurd. When reconciliation with Great Britain became impossible, and when independence was declared in 1776, the new American nation was nothing more than an ambitious experiment in republican self-government. There was no guarantee of its success, and several good reasons to expect its failure. "We have not men fit for the times," wrote John Adams. "We are deficient in genius, in education, in travel, in fortune, in everything. I feel unutterable anxiety." Nevertheless, despite Adams's pessimism, these United States of America, a term first coined by Jefferson in June 1776, quickly became what George III feared, an independent empire. By 1826, after only 5 decades of independence, the American Union had become the imperial master of much of North America and the self-proclaimed guardian of the Western Hemisphere. Diplomacy and war were essential to the creation and the survival of the United States. It was only with foreign assistance that the Revolutionary War was won. Even when independence was secured in 1783 by the Treaty of Paris, the new republic was surrounded by European colonies and hostile forces. To the north, smarting from their recent defeat, were the British in Canada. To the south, governing the Gulf of Mexico, was Spanish Florida. To the west were Native American tribes and Spanish Louisiana, which controlled the vital conduit of the Mississippi and the port of New Orleans. Independence did not bring security. The initial borders of the United States were painfully vulnerable to European and indigenous forces. "American troops," wrote James Madison, "were an object of contempt to the inimical tribes with which we are surrounded. It is also to be apprehended that we suffer much from the agency of British and Spanish partisans." The presence of these hostile powers meant that the United States, the American Empire, could not and did not expand inexorably into a continental vacuum. Territorial growth was not the manifest destiny of the nation. In fact, it required careful planning, negotiation with rival empires, and the steady, guided use of military force. It was not a coincidence that each of the 4 presidents elected between 1800 and 1824 had also been Secretary of State. More prosaically, but no less importantly, the United States needed to make international trade deals. Although possessed of an abundance of natural resources, the American economy, where it went beyond the bountiful but cash-poor agriculture of Western settlements, was commercial and mercantile. The clear majority of Americans lived within 50 miles of the eastern coast, and all the leading cities, Boston, New York, Philadelphia, Charleston, and Savannah, were ports whose merchants depended upon international custom. Yet by declaring independence from Great Britain, American merchants were denied favorable terms of trade with the British and the remaining colonies. This was potentially disastrous, because from the first tobacco planted in Virginia to the first ships launched in Massachusetts, the American economy had been designed to supply the British Empire. American diplomats urgently needed to negotiate better access to British markets, to make deals with other European nations, and even to arrange the protection of American shipping from the pirates of the West Indies and North Africa. Most significant of all, by trying to build a federal government to support and sustain its independence, the United States was obliged to answer 3 challenges that faced all aspiring masters of the North American continent. First, How to Best Acquire New Lands While Defending Settlers from Hostile Native Americans and Other Foreign Powers. Second, how could political and military control be exerted over distant and extensive territories? Third, what was the most appropriate and affordable system of government that could unite such a diverse nation? These questions had confounded the British, and the success and survival of the United States were therefore contingent upon the right choices being made by politicians at home, by diplomats at negotiating tables, and by military men in the field. Missteps and humiliations, like Zebulon Pike's calamitous expedition, were the frequent result of this ad hoc process. However, in the half-century following 1776, American politicians, diplomats, and generals found workable answers to their challenges. By doing so, American leaders also confirmed the imperial character of the nation. The United States might have been Republican, and in the words of Jefferson, an empire of liberty, but by conquering territory, by subjugating Native Americans and European settlers, and by developing and then using military force, the United States became the paramount empire in North America, an independent empire. Chapter 1. The British and the Problems of American Empire. The rulers of Great Britain have, for more than a century past, amused the people with the imagination that they possessed a great empire on the west side of the Atlantic. This empire, however, has hitherto existed in imagination only. It has been not an empire, but the project of an empire. Not a gold mine, but the project of a gold mine. It is surely now time that our rulers should either realize this golden dream, in which they have been indulging themselves, perhaps, as well as the people, or that they should awake from it themselves and endeavor to awaken the people. Adam Smith, The Wealth of Nations, 1776. If the 15th century belonged to the Portuguese, and the 16th to the Spanish, and if the 17th century was defined by la gloire of the Sun King, King Louis XIV, it was in the long 18th century that Great Britain emerged as a global force. This rise to power began with the Glorious Revolution of 1688, when the Catholic King James II was deposed and replaced by William of Orange, the Protestant Dutch stadtholder. According to its most revered historian, this was, of all revolutions, the least violent and the most beneficent, being both the signal of deliverance of England from popery and absolutism and the vindication of ancient rights. Crowned at Westminster Abbey as William III, the new king was a pensive, severe, and solemn man who had never been young. He soon dragged his British subjects into his ongoing continental war with France, the War of the League of Augsburg. With memorable military victories at the Boyne in Ireland and La Hogue off the Normandy coast, and with the concurrent development of stable parliamentary government in London, the British ascent had begun. 9 years of war against France were ended by the Treaty of Ryswick, 1697, but this brought only momentary peace. In 1700, Europe was again thrown into turmoil when the King of Spain, the infirm and bewitched Carlos II, died without issue. Addled by generations of inbreeding, the Habsburg line of Philip II had failed, and by 1702, the nations of Europe were fighting over who would ascend the Spanish throne. In this, the War of the Spanish Succession, the British were established as a major military power. The Duke of Marlborough, the direct ancestor of Winston Churchill, recorded stunning triumphs over French forces at Ramilly, Oudenarde, Malplaquet, and notably Blenheim, after which he wrote to his wife Sarah that God had blessed Her Majesty's army with as great a victory as has ever been known. Marlborough's royal reward was the construction of the magnificent Blenheim Palace in Oxfordshire, and his success produced the terms of the Peace of Utrecht, 1713, that made Britain dominant in the Atlantic world. The British were given the asiento, the effective monopoly of the lucrative slave trade from Africa to Spanish America, the control of Gibraltar and Menorca in the Mediterranean, and possession of the New World colonies of Newfoundland, Nova Scotia, and St. Kitts. With the death in 1714 of Queen Anne, the last Stuart monarch, the British throne passed to a middle-aged German prince of the House of Hanover. George I was far from the model king. He was deeply stupid, indolent, and irascible. He could speak not a word of English, and his divorce and imprisonment of his wife had earned him a justified reputation for vengeful cruelty. He was, however, Protestant, and that mattered most. George I was also the first British monarch to have a prime minister, with Robert Walpole establishing power in the wake of the financial crisis caused by the South Sea bubble. In the reign of his son, George II, there came the War of the Austrian Succession, 1740-48, which saw the king himself lead troops into battle at Dettingen in Germany. Despite British defeat at the Battle of Fontenoy in present-day Belgium in 1745, the Treaty of Aix-la-Chapelle, 1748, allowed the British to renew the Asiento and to regain the Indian city of Madras. George Friedrich Handel, who had written Zadok the Priest for George II's coronation, celebrated the peace by composing Music for the Royal Fireworks. In domestic politics, the reigns of the first two Georges were not without drama. In both 1715 and 1745, the Hanoverian monarchy was challenged by the rebellion of Jacobites, who remained loyal to the deposed Catholic line of the House of Stuart. The latter of these risings was led by the young pretender, Bonnie Prince Charlie. But a decisive victory for governmental forces at Culloden in the Scottish Highlands meant that Britain's constitutional monarchy survived and grew stable. The British ascendancy was confirmed by the Seven Years' War, 1756-63, begun under the reign of George II, and concluded by the Treaty of Paris, of the accession of his grandson, George III. Known in North America as the French and Indian War, this was a global conflict, the First World War. Its theaters ranged from Quebec to West Africa, from the cockpit of Europe in the Netherlands to the subcontinent of India, and the British left these battlefields as the world's leading political, commercial, and colonial power. National heroes were made of James Wolfe, who died on the plains of Abraham outside Quebec, and Robert Clive, the commander-in-chief of British India. By the terms of the peace, Great Britain won recognition of its Indian enclaves and gained control of French Canada, a host of Caribbean islands, and the two Floridas, East Florida and West Florida, on the Gulf of Mexico. Even more significantly, the French were humiliated. Yet such was Britain's position of strength that many regarded the Treaty of Paris as a diplomatic failure. One truculent observer even wrote that its terms had drawn the contempt of mankind on our wretched negotiators. This, then, was the British Empire of the 1700s, unmatched in extent and wealth, and a global power without peer. The growth of the British Empire, however, had come at a cost. To finance the Seven Years' War, the government had borrowed extensively from domestic and Dutch bankers, causing the national debt nearly to double, from £72 million sterling in 1755 to almost £130 million in 1764. Moreover, with the addition of French Canada to the American colonies, the ongoing expense of defending this transatlantic empire had increased enormously. The government calculated that it would cost more than £220,000 per year to station 10,000 additional troops in North America. And this deployment was rendered all the more urgent by the outbreak of Pontiac's Rebellion in 1763. Here, the decision of the British General Geoffrey Amherst to stop traditional payments and presents to Indian allies had provoked a confederacy of Native Americans into attacks on British forts and towns throughout the Great Lakes region. All but three forts were destroyed, and more than 2,000 settlers were slain. Amherst elected to respond in kind. "I am determined to take every measure in my power," he declared, "not only for securing and keeping entire possession of the country, but for punishing those barbarians who have thus perfidiously massacred His Majesty's subjects." The British general even tried to pioneer the egregious art of biological warfare, asking one of his colonels, could it not be contrived to send the smallpox among the disaffected tribes of Indians? With Pontiac threatening the security of the American colonies, it was incumbent upon George Greenville, who had replaced the unpopular Earl of Bute as Prime Minister, to find new means of financing the defense of Britain's Western Empire. Taxation and trade. Before 1765, the American colonies had been tightly bound into the British imperial economy, and so to the British exchequer. British taxation of the Americans was indirect, which meant that taxes were levied not on income, assets, or domestic produce, but on exports and imports. In accordance with Britain's navigation laws, American trade was routed through London, from which a watchful eye made sure these taxes were paid. Besides this, American industrial development was discouraged by a ban on competition with British manufacturers. The boon of the Industrial Revolution, fueled by the inventions of Thomas Newcomen, and Richard Arkwright, and James Hargreaves, would be protected at all costs. American exportation to Britain of certain goods, grain, and meat was meanwhile outlawed completely. Not yet the free trade nation of David Ricardo and Richard Cobden, Great Britain in the 1760s was protectionist and jealous, even of its own colonies. All this chafed the Americans, but British economic policy was tolerated because it was imperfectly enforced and easily circumvented. Smuggling, for instance, was rife along the eastern seaboard, and shipping illicit rum and molasses from the West Indies was a popular and profitable display of defiance. When the British Parliament passed the Stamp Act in 1765 to raise money for the defense of the American colonies, it represented something different. It was the first attempt to impose direct taxation upon the colonists. Replicating a measure that had raised revenue effortlessly in Great Britain, the Stamp Act stipulated, first, that a wide range of documents had to be printed on paper imported from London, and, second, that the documents had to carry a revenue stamp that could be purchased only from colonial officials. Thomas Whately, the junior minister who had drawn up the Stamp Act, deemed this mode of taxation to be the easiest, the most equal, and the most certain that can be chosen. The ministers cleared the proposal with the agents of the colonies in London, who raised no objection. When it reached the colonies, however, Americans protested that this parliamentary direct taxation scheme was unconstitutional because the colonists were not represented, notwithstanding the British counterargument of virtual representation, in Parliament. The scenario prompted many well-read Americans to recall the personal rule of Charles I and the ship money controversy, when coastal areas of England were taxed by the king without legislative consent. The comparison might have been apt, but London still expected the colonists to pay up. After all, the tax had been authorized by Parliament, whose authority had been supreme since the Glorious Revolution. Many at Westminster also blamed the Americans for starting the Seven Years' War in the first place, so they believed the colonists should pay for what they had brought upon themselves. Charles Townsend, the MP for Harwich, derided any kind of opposition to the tax. "Will these Americans," he asked, "children, planted by our care, nourished up by our indulgence until they are grown to a degree of strength and opulence and protected by our arms, will they grudge to contribute their mite to relieve us from the heavy weight of the burden which we lie under?" The Americans were to disappoint Townsend, for the breaking news of the tax caused civil unrest throughout the colonies. Archibald Hinchelwood, a Nova Scotia lawyer, wrote to the distiller Joshua Mauger of a violent spirit of opposition raised on the continent against the execution of the Stamp Act. Effigies of Andrew Oliver, the colonial official responsible for collecting the tax in Britain, were hung by the Sons of Liberty from the city's Liberty Tree. Attached to Oliver's effigy was a sign stating, "He that takes this down is an enemy to his country." The uproar was contagious. The Stamp Act also provoked the rancor of a more sophisticated constituency. By taxing printed materials such as newspapers and legal documents, it directly affected the journalists and lawyers who were best placed to articulate colonial discontent. One such lawyer was John Adams, a bustling attorney in the provincial town of Braintree, Massachusetts. Recently married to his third cousin Abigail, and already dabbling in political theory, Adams marveled in his diary at the fury provoked by the tax. "The year 1765 has been the most remarkable year of my life. That enormous engine fabricated by the British Parliament for battering down all the rights and liberties of America, I mean the Stamp Act, has raised and spread through the whole continent a spirit that will be recorded to our honor. In every colony, from Georgia to New Hampshire inclusively, the stamp distributors and inspectors have been compelled by the unconquerable rage of the people to renounce their offices." Along the seaboard, throughout the colonies, a unifying political consciousness emerged. The people, even to the lowest ranks, have become more attentive to their liberties, more inquisitive about them, and more determined to defend them than they were ever before, Adams wrote. The collective response of the colonists was to convene the Stamp Act Congress. Representatives of 9 mainland colonies, Massachusetts, Rhode Island, Connecticut, New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Delaware, Maryland, and South Carolina, met in New York City in October 1765. Few details of the debates survive, but after 3 weeks of deliberation in the City Hall and New York's coffee houses and taverns, the delegates reached a conclusion that would be repeated so long as the Americans could imagine being British subjects. Parliament could regulate the external trade of the colonies, but it could not impose direct taxes on American colonists who were not directly represented before the king. Put more pithily, the colonists demanded, "No taxation without representation." It was a memorable turn of phrase, rooted in the Americans' belief that only local assemblies could legitimately levy taxes in the colonies. Yet one must also consider that few Americans had any real interest in being represented at Westminster. The major insuperable obstacle was the distance involved, and Massachusetts lawyer James Otis described the idea as generally much disliked in the colonies and thought impracticable. Indeed, the objections to representation in Westminster essentially reduced the Americans' argument to no taxation, at least by Parliament. Other developments in London encouraged the colonists to place more trust in their colonial assemblies than in Parliament. The treatment of John Wilkes was the major case in point. Wilkes was a scurrilous radical, a notorious scoundrel, and a leading member of Sir Francis Dashwood's debauched Hellfire Club. Famously ugly, and once described as a most shocking dog to look at, Wilkes relied on a razor-sharp wit to make friends, curry favor, and deflect criticism. When told by the Earl of Sandwich, the eponym of the snack, "Sir, I do not know whether you will die of the gallows or the pox," Wilkes replied, "That depends, my lord, on whether I embrace your lordship's principles or your mistress." He was also an MP and a journalist, who employed his weekly publication, The North Briton, to lampoon and harangue both court and parliament. Yet, when in 1763 the North Briton disparaged George III and the Treaty of Paris, a line was crossed, and there were calls for his expulsion from the House of Commons. When Parliament met to discuss the matter, and when Wilkes's pornographic Essay on Woman, a satire on Pope's Essay on Man, was read aloud by Sandwich, the hysterical outcry forced Wilkes to flee to Paris. Tried in absentia for obscene and seditious libel, Wilkes was found guilty and declared an outlaw. As news of the Wilkes controversy arrived from the motherland, the American colonists became ever more concerned by Parliament's self-interested and heavy-handed conduct. In this context, the imposition of direct taxation assumed increasingly sinister connotations. Colonial opposition to the Stamp Act was soon joined by British merchants whose business had been affected by the tax. Led by Barlow Trecothick, a former Bostonian and an MP for London, they formed a powerful, effective lobby. In March 1766, only 4 months after the Stamp Act came into force, it was repealed by the Whig administration, led by the Marquess of Rockingham. The repeal was a triumph for the colonists, proof that organized resistance to British policy could yield momentous results. Parliament, however, had not conceded the principle of its authority. Indeed, the repeal of the Stamp Act was accompanied by a new law that reaffirmed Parliament's inviolable right to make laws for the colonies. The Declaratory Act proclaimed that Parliament, being the Lords spiritual and temporal and Commons of Great Britain, hath, and of right ought to have, full power and authority to make laws and statutes of sufficient force and validity to bind the colonies and people of America in all cases whatsoever. Parliament was taking a stand. The principles of both sides were soon put to the test. In 1767, Charles Townshend, now Chancellor of the Exchequer in a new government led by William Pitt the Elder, pushed a new series of bills through Parliament. Known as the Townshend Acts, they were crafted as another means of raising money from the colonies. The Main Revenue Act was designed to make a more certain and adequate provision for defraying the charge of the administration of justice and the support of civil government in such provinces where it shall be found necessary, and towards further defraying the expenses of defending, protecting, and securing the said dominions. This would be done by levying taxes on flint, glass, lead, paint, tea, and every variety of paper. There was a practical, understandable aspect to the Townshend Acts. Quite simply, Parliament needed the money. The Chancellor, however, was also trying to make a point about parliamentary authority. "The superiority of the mother country," he declared, "can at no time be better exerted than now." Townshend knew the duties would be unpopular, but he nevertheless expected the Americans to accept them as the kind of external, indirect taxes to which they had supposedly consented. Again, Townshend misjudged the Americans. In an atmosphere already radicalized by the Stamp Act, colonial objection was reflexive. In his Letters from a Pennsylvania Farmer, the Philadelphia lawyer John Dickinson railed that any taxes levied by Parliament on Americans designed purely to raise revenue were unconstitutional. Merchants began to boycott British produce, and colonial courts refused to uphold the rights of the newly appointed customs commissioners. In fact, colonial courts, with their colonial juries, were happy to try royal officials for enforcing the new laws and to acquit civilians for attacks on the same officials. London's apoplectic response was to bypass the obstructive colonial judiciary by creating vice admiralty courts that could operate without juries. As the relationship deteriorated, the Boston merchant John Hancock wrote to colleagues that Massachusetts, as well as America in general, is now reduced to melancholy and very alarming circumstances. The problem, he thought, was that taxes equally detrimental to the commercial interests of the parent country and the colonies are imposed upon the people without their consent. Despite petitions to court and parliament, the colonists were suffering the infringement of a right naturally inherent in every man and expressly recognized by the glorious revolution as the birthright of an Englishman. Even an eventual loyalist like the jurist William Smith, who would flee to New York and become Chief Justice of Quebec, saw that to tax the colonies by act of Parliament was to totally dis-Anglify them. For the most part, the British defended their policy fiercely. Writing to the London Chronicle, the pseudonymous Anti-Sejanus propounded the necessity of enforcing the Stamp Act with spirit and resolution, and he damned the waywardness and ingratitude of the Americans. Many others were determined to make an example of the insubordinate colonists. Benjamin Franklin, the Pennsylvanian polymath, was at the time a colonial agent in London, and he observed that every man in England seems to consider himself as a piece of sovereign over America, seems to jostle himself into the throne with the king, and talks of our subjects in the colonies. There were few dissenting voices among British politicians, but the most eloquent belonged to Edmund Burke, the man of letters and Whig statesman. "If parliamentary sovereignty and their freedom cannot be reconciled," Burke asked the Commons, "which will the colonists take?" He answered, of course, that they will cast your sovereignty in your face. Nobody will be argued into slavery. As is often the case, Burke was prophetic, but he would go unheeded. All the while, the saga of John Wilkes continued to blacken American perceptions of Parliament. In 1769, Wilkes returned to England and twice won re-election to the Commons. The Commons, however, refused to let him take his seat, and Henry Luttrell, Wilkes's defeated opponent in the second election, was declared the winner instead. To Americans holding radical Whig beliefs about popular sovereignty, it was increasingly apparent that Parliament was a self-appointing oligarchy, answerable to corrupt interests, not to the electorate. The cry of Wilkes and Liberty became a standard of colonial protest, and the Wilkes controversy even triggered the collapse of royal government in South Carolina. In December 1769, the colony's House of Assembly ordered a grant of £1,500 in support of our fellow subjects, who by asserting the just rights of the people have or shall become obnoxious to administration and suffer from the hand of power. Naturally, they meant Wilkes, but South Carolina's lieutenant governor, under orders from London, refused to sign off on the grant. Cooperation on all matters between his office, the colony's council, and the House of Assembly soon ground to a bad-tempered halt. In Massachusetts, dissent became so fierce that Lord Hillsborough, the colonial secretary at Westminster, instructed Thomas Gage, the British commander-in-chief in North America, to send such force as you shall think necessary to Boston. Yet the presence of the Redcoats, far from having a pacific influence, served only to heighten the tension in the city. It boiled over on March 5, 1770. That night, a British soldier, Hugh White, was on duty outside the Custom House on King Street when Edward Garrick, a local wigmaker's apprentice, walked past and provoked an altercation. When Private White struck Garrick with his musket, a crowd gathered, and church bells were rung, bringing hundreds more to King Street. Surrounded by the angry locals, White called for reinforcements, and 7 troops were sent as relief. The young bookseller Henry Knox tried to defuse the situation, pleading with Thomas Preston, the British officer. For God's sake, take care of your men! If they fire, your life must be answerable! Yet when something was thrown at the soldiers, the Redcoats replied with a shot. As the mob retaliated with fists and cudgels, the British unleashed a volley. 6 civilians were injured, and 5 were killed. Known in the colonies as the Boston Massacre, and to the British as the Incident on King Street, the events were memorialized and embellished by Paul Revere. Unhappy Boston! See thy sons deplore thy hallowed walks besmeared with guiltless gore, while faithless Preston and his savage bands with murderous rancor stretch their bloody hands, like fierce barbarians grinning o'er their prey, approve the carnage and enjoy the day. To calm the waters, the aftermath of the massacre was managed carefully. John Adams, driven by his belief in the right to counsel, defended the soldiers before a Boston jury, and though 2 were convicted of manslaughter, 6 were acquitted. The longer-term impact of the Boston Massacre was more profound, for Adams later wrote that, in the violence of the Redcoats on the evening of March 5, 1770, the foundation of American independence was laid. The Boston Massacre, however, was not the only momentous event of that early spring day. Across the Atlantic, Lord Frederick North, a portly and vacillating Tory, was now Prime Minister, the 7th to serve George III since 1762. Only a few hours before Private White struck Edward Garrick, North had presented a motion in the House of Commons calling for the partial repeal of the Townshend Acts. Within a month, many of the objectionable duties had been lifted, but one would remain, the tax on tea. Tea and the Intolerable Acts. For 3 years, from 1770, there was a false peace between the American colonies and the Parliament at Westminster. Even when the government schooner Gaspy ran aground in Rhode Island and was burned by a mob of tax protesters, the threat of conflagration was contained. The Tea Act of 1773, however, revived and aggregated the latent problems of trade and taxation. On the surface, the act was designed to let the financially troubled East India Company dump its surplus tea tax-free on the American colonies. The company, the Leviathan of the British imperial economy, would benefit by not paying export duties to London. The Americans, or so Westminster presumed, would benefit by importing cheaper tea. Yet such tea would still have the Townsend duty levied on it. And so, the act was perceived as an underhanded means of foisting further taxation on the Americans. When news of the Tea Act reached the colonies, resistance was organized immediately, and that resistance culminated, as every schoolchild used to know, on December 16, 1773, when a gang of patriots, some of them disguised as Mohawk Indians, stalked aboard the Dartmouth in Boston Harbor and dumped 342 chests of East Indian tea into the water. It was a stunning act of political vandalism. The cargo was worth close to £10,000, just short of $4 million in today's money. And John Adams likened the Tea Party to Caesar crossing the Rubicon. "The die is cast," he wrote in his diary. "The people have passed the river and cut away the bridge. This is the grandest event which has ever yet happened since the controversy with Britain opened." Reports of the Tea Party reached London in January 1774, and, initially, were met with incredulity. George III, who maintained a fervent desire to keep the Americans under control, could not believe that "the instigation of bad men hath again drawn the people of Boston to take such unjustifiable steps." When more detailed reports of colonial subversion were received, that incredulity turned to outrage. By March, the House of Lords was discussing measures "for enforcing all due obedience to the laws of this kingdom throughout all His Majesty's dominions." The British government's eventual response was a series of laws designed to punish the Bostonians for their impudence. In London, they were called the Coercive Acts. In the colonies, they were termed intolerable. The first of them, the Boston Port Act, closed the city's harbor until restitution for the destroyed tea was made to the British Treasury and the East India Company. The act also condemned the dangerous commotions and insurrections which had been fomented and raised in the town. The Massachusetts Government Act was even more contentious, remodeling the government of the colony so that power was concentrated in the hands of the London-appointed governor, Thomas Gage. The Administration of Justice Act became law on the same day. It meant that royal officials could be tried outside of Massachusetts, far from the potentially vindictive judgment of Boston juries. George Washington, stirred from his agrarian calling at Mount Vernon, called it the Murder Act, because it seemed that British officials could now commit any manner of atrocity and escape punishment. The fourth intolerable act was an amendment to the Quartering Act of 1765. Applicable to all the colonies, it allowed royal governors to provide housing for British soldiers by seizing buildings, should the colonial assemblies fail to provide accommodation themselves. A fifth law of 1774 was equally intolerable, for if the four canonical acts underscored the incompetence of British imperial governance, the Quebec Act showed how the British failed, and could hardly help but fail in light of their wider responsibilities in North America, to satisfy the expansionist ambitions of George III's American subjects. Although the Act's provisions applied only to the province of Quebec, which had been newly created from the ceded territory of French Canada, they were of immense concern to the American colonists to the south. For one thing, the Quebec Act gave the French Canadiens freedom to worship as Catholics. It also removed reference to the Protestant faith from their oath of allegiance and restored the Catholic Church's right to impose tithes in Canada. For the first time since 1689, then, the British Crown had recognized Catholic authority in its territories. For some Protestants in the American colonies, this represented the dereliction of George III's sacred duty, as sworn to in his coronation oath, to maintain the Protestant religion. One patriot reportedly declared that "the king had broke his coronation oath by establishing the Roman Catholic religion at Quebec, and that he could not in conscience serve His Majesty, and that he would not, on any occasion or for any consideration, supply the king's troops then at Boston with any kind of relief or necessaries." Even worse, Quebec would be ruled by a crown-appointed governor. The governor would be assisted by a legislative council, but he would appoint that council himself, and there was no provision for an elected assembly of colonists. The Quebec Act, therefore, seemed to establish the kind of arbitrary government against which free-born Britons and free-born British American colonists had been fighting since the reign of Charles I. As a further affront to American sensibilities, English common law would be applied only selectively. In many affairs, the Canadien would be subject to French civil law. From London's perspective, the Quebec Act made sense. The province had 75,000 French colonists and only 3,000 British settlers, including American newcomers from the South. By allowing the operation of certain elements of French law, and by preventing the subjugation of the French by a British minority, the Act sought to mollify the conquered majority. The Quebec Act also appeased the Native Americans whom the British now governed. George III had replaced Onontio, their term for the governor of New France, as their protector. In such ways, the Quebec Act was successful, securing the civil and religious rights of the French Canadiens under a tolerable form of government, while protecting Native Americans from the enmity and greed of the whites. The 3,000 British settlers, however, were incensed, and their sentiment was shared by their American brethren. Unchecked, arbitrary government seemed to have become London's policy for all America. Worse still was the redefinition of Quebec's borders. American settlers might have fled political, religious, and economic oppression in Europe, but they were also drawn to the New World by the promise of their own land, their own farm, their own plantation. As populations swelled along the eastern coastline, settlers moved inland in pursuit of fresh, uncultivated soil, and this desire to move west, to push back the frontier, quickly became essential to the American psyche. One of the triggers of the Seven Years' War, the 1754 killing of the French officer Joseph Coulon de Jumonville, stemmed from this impulse. George Washington's troops met the French only because the Ohio Company had paid for the defense of virgin land. 2 years after Jumonville was killed, the New York official Peter Raxall noted that an unaccountable thirst for large tracts of land hath prevailed over the inhabitants of this and the neighboring provinces with a singular rage. London, however, impeded expansion at almost every turn. When French Canada was ceded to the British in 1763, the Americans had expected that western lands would be open for cultivation. But that year's royal proclamation forbade white settlement to the west of the Appalachians. Extensive lands were reserved instead for His Majesty's Indian subjects, and some colonists found themselves on the wrong side of the line. 11 years later, much of this land was turned over to Quebec, which, far from the settled parts of old French Canada, now extended southward and westward to incorporate parts of present-day Illinois, Indiana, Michigan, Ohio, Wisconsin, and Minnesota. London, it seemed, would stop at nothing to frustrate the ambitions of the Americans. Combined with the oppressive taxation and the intolerable acts, the Quebec Act convinced many that Parliament wished to degrade the colonies into subservience. Answering the call for united resistance, 12 of the 13 colonies sent delegates to Philadelphia, where the First Continental Congress was convened in September 1774. Sitting for less than 8 weeks in Carpenter's Hall, the Congress agreed to two measures. First, a boycott of all British goods from December 1, 1774, which crippled British exports to the colonies. Second, a petition to George III for the repeal of the Intolerable Acts, claiming that all American distresses, dangers, fears, and jealousies flowed from the destructive system of colony administration adopted since the conclusion of the last war. Congress begged the king's clemency for protection. The petition reached London, but it was ignored. "It came down among a great heap of letters," reported Benjamin Franklin, "and I do not find that it has had any further notice taken of it." The colonists' pleas were disregarded. Within months, the crisis would descend into war. From crisis to war. The British had failed to establish equitable systems of colonial commerce and taxation. They had failed to reform colonial government adequately. In fact, The Admiralty Courts and Customs Boards had encouraged dissension, not fraternity. The British had also failed to satisfy the expansionist ambitions of their colonists. In short, the British failed to govern their American empire. Such failures filled a powder keg, and the match was lit on the night of April 19, 1775. Acting on intelligence that a cache of Patriot arms had been stored in the Massachusetts village of Concord, 700 British regulars, commanded by Lieutenant Colonel Francis Smith, crossed the Charles Estuary and began marching toward their quarry in Middlesex County. When the British came to the village of Lexington, the Patriot militia, informed of the British mission by the midnight ride of Paul Revere, made a show of defiance. Shots were fired, and, outnumbered almost 10-1, the colonists fell back. The British marched on and soon arrived, the sun now risen, at their destination of Concord. The redcoats split up and began searching for the munitions, which the colonists had long since moved. At the town's north bridge, about 100 royal troops came upon 400 Patriot militiamen. What followed is celebrated famously in Ralph Waldo Emerson's Concord Hymn. By the rude bridge that arched the flood, their flag to April's breeze unfurled, here once the embattled farmer stood and fired the shot heard around the world. Gradually, the British retreated from Concord and then withdrew to Charlestown, harried all the way by militia from the surrounding countryside. On hearing the news from Lexington and Concord, the colony's provincial congress organized the Massachusetts Line of regular troops. Forces from across New England soon gathered to besiege the British base of Boston. Indeed, patriots and redcoats began to clash throughout the northern colonies. In May 1775, the New York fort of Ticonderoga was seized, in the name of the great Jehovah and the Continental Congress, from an undermanned British garrison by Ethan Allen's Green Mountain Boys. The largest defensive complex in the northern colonies, Ticonderoga, occupied a key position on the Great Warpath between New York and Montreal, and its loss, compounded by the seizure of its heavy artillery, was a telling strategic blow to the British. In June, the newly formed Continental Army commenced its first major expedition, the invasion of Canada. Seeking to deprive the British of a major military base and to encourage the Canadiens to join the revolution, two American armies were led by the Irish-born Richard Montgomery and the Connecticut merchant Benedict Arnold. Having set out from Ticonderoga, Montgomery quickly took Montreal, almost capturing the British general Guy Carleton. But when he joined with Arnold, they were repelled by the British, led by Carleton, from the fortified town of Quebec. A diplomatic delegation, including Benjamin Franklin, then failed to persuade all but a few Canadiens to rebel. The Americans might have had the sympathies of the French peasantry and many of the ordinary English settlers. Two regiments of young men would eventually leave in the summer of 76 with the American retreat. But the Canadian gentry reasoned that the Quebec Act had given them all they could expect from an English-speaking government. Moreover, the Americans, having failed to dislodge the British from the fortress of Quebec, could not offer the Canadien an outlet to the wider world. Early American success, whether military or diplomatic, was far from certain. As 1775 drew on, reconciliation with the motherland became ever less likely. The British were besieged in Boston, and when, on June 17th, they attempted to clear Patriot encampments on the Charlestown Peninsula, open battle was waged again. The first two British assaults, bloody and brutal both, were turned back. The third, when the Patriots ran out of ammunition, was not. Much of the fighting occurred on Breed's Hill, but the battle was named for the nearby Bunker Hill, which overlooked the Mystic River. It was nonetheless a Pyrrhic victory for the British. Henry Clinton, who later became British Commander-in-Chief, wrote that a few more such victories would have shortly put an end to British dominion in America. Even worse was the dawning reality that the rebels had raised a disciplined military force. An anonymous officer of rank wrote home that, "We have learned one melancholy truth, which is that the Americans, if they were equally well commanded, are full as good soldiers as ours." By the summer of 1775, then, American independence was no longer a spurious fantasy, and many Britons began to accept that self-government was the sincere, realistic ambition of the rebels. Permanent separation was not necessarily the determined goal across the colonies. But when George III refused to receive Richard Penn and Arthur Lee, the envoys who carried Congress's last-ditch olive branch petition, most Americans were decided in their choice. As the king then told Parliament in October 1775, "The rebellious war now levied has become more general and is manifestly carried on for the purpose of establishing an independent empire." Tom Paine. Thomas Paine was the Norfolk-born son of a corset maker. A thin man, with a sharp nose and a red face, Paine had been a privateer and a schoolteacher in London before he settled in 1768 in Lewes, a Sussex town with a rich history of protesting royal authority. He was an unreliable, possibly incompetent employee. In 1774, Paine was dismissed as an exciseman because of repeated, unexplained absences from work. Laden with debts incurred during an unsuccessful venture as a tobacconist, he sold his belongings and, following a chance encounter with Benjamin Franklin, emigrated to the American colonies. Arriving in Philadelphia on the London packet, Paine took an immediate interest in the colonial crisis, and when, in February 1775, he became editor of the Pennsylvania Magazine, he began his career as the leading propagandist of the American Revolution. Trebling the sales of the magazine within 5 months, Paine depicted American resistance to British policy in righteous, millennial terms. "We live not in the world of angels," he counseled. "The reign of Satan is not ended." In late 1775, as the Americans trod the path toward independence, Paine began to write Common Sense, a pamphlet that became the manifesto of the revolution. Published in January 1776, when the British were in Boston and the Continental Army was occupying Montreal, Common Sense was a searing indictment of British maladministration and a clarion call for immediate independence. It was also one of the most influential documents in the history of American foreign policy. For a long time, as historian Felix Gilbert noted in the 1960s, every American utterance in foreign policy starts from Paine's words and echoes his thought. Paine's vision was clear and audacious. Although resident in the New World for little more than a year, he had already foreseen the expansion of the independent colonies across the American continent. Continental, indeed, was a word Paine used often. He meant it literally, referring to Quebec, the Ohio Valley, the Trans-Appalachian West, and beyond. Paine's continental empire would expand northward at the expense of British Canada, westward at the expense of Native Americans, and southward at the expense of the Spanish. The last vestiges of French interests would suffer too. Supremacy was the destiny of the continental American empire, just as the scale of the continent made independence inevitable. "There is something very absurd," reasoned Paine, "in supposing a continent to be perpetually governed by an island. For, in no instance hath nature made the satellite larger than its primary planet." Paine's continental empire would be republican, organized by fundamental laws and popular charter, and defined by popular sovereignty. There would be a strong central government that would support and not repress the people's rights to religious freedom and property. It would also mobilize the resources of the continent in the cause of self-defense. "No country on the globe," wrote Paine, "is so happily situated or so internally capable of raising a fleet as America. We need to go abroad for nothing." Paine prescribed to the new republic only limited interaction with the overthrown motherland, which belonged to a different world. "England to Europe, America to herself." Nor was there any prospect of reconciliation, since "England consults the good of this country no farther than it answers her own purpose." Cutting the imperial cord would protect Americans from wars they would never wage of their own accord. So, independence meant happy divorce from the balance of power chicanery that had defined European politics since 1648's Peace of Westphalia. American international relations would be purely commercial. The chains of the Navigation Acts would be broken, restrictive British policies would be abandoned, and the American Empire would be a free port for global commerce. This may strike some modern listeners as the first major articulation of American isolationism. For Paine, it was simply common sense. More than 500,000 copies of Common Sense were printed or copied during the Revolution. That was one for every 5 Americans. Proportionally, it remains the most widely read American publication of all time, and perhaps the most important. "Without the pen of the author of Common Sense," John Adams reportedly observed, "the sword of Washington would have been raised in vain."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.